The story begins here, at Apple Park in Cupertino. Not where you would expect a story about Qualcomm's Snapdragon X Elite to start, but it's likely the very place where first ideas of what would much later become the CPU cores of the X Elite originated. Although I have to be careful with my words, because this question already started a lawsuit once before. When Apple created the original iPhone, a new type of chip was needed to meet the demands of a mobile phone with a large touchscreen. Since Apple wasn't a chip design company, they had to work with a third party, and they chose Samsung. Samsung designed and manufactured the initial iPhone SoCs, which combined ARM CPU cores with PowerVR graphics. But Apple wanted more control over their chips, which is why they acquired Palo Alto Semiconductor in 2008, better known as PA Semi, for $278 million. With the newly acquired chip design team, Apple went right to work and designed its first in-house SoC, the Apple A4. The A4 was very similar to the previous chips designed by Samsung. It still used Cortex CPU cores from ARM, PowerVR graphics, and Samsung continued to handle the manufacturing mostly in Samsung's fab in Austin, Texas, which is especially relevant today with all the talk about bringing manufacturing back to the US. Early iPhone SoCs were US designed and made. In 2010, Apple acquired another semiconductor company called Intrinsity, and with it their fast 14 electronic design automation software. The acquisition of these EDA tools allowed Apple to implement dynamic logic designs, which increased the performance characteristics of their chips. Apple was quickly becoming a fabless semiconductor company, and after just two generations of in-house SoCs, the Apple A6 ushered in a new era. For the first time ever, Apple didn't license CPU cores from ARM, but instead built a custom CPU, codenamed Swift, based on a modified ARMv7a architecture. There are two ways to get access to an ARM-based CPU. The most common way is to directly license one of the pre-built designs that ARM offers, for example, a Cortex CPU. But you can go one step further and get an architecture license, which allows you to build your own CPU based on the proprietary ARM instruction set architecture. This type of license is more expensive, but it gives you more freedom and control. And Apple did just that. They bought an architecture license from ARM, and the Swift cores inside the A6 were the result of this new design direction. And before you ask, yes, this is still a video about Qualcomm's Snapdragon X Elite. Just bear with me. The A6 was an inflection point for Apple and jump-started the domination of Apple Silicon in the years to come. Apple invested heavily into their chip design department, attracting and forming many of the world's top ARM chip architects. With each new generation, Apple Silicon further increased its lead over the competition. Building on that success, Apple started to increase the scope of its SoC designs, going from smartphones to laptops and eventually desktop-grade chips. I'm sure everyone watching this video knows how big of a leap the Apple M1 generation really was. Apple's ARM-based CPU architectures dominate not only in performance, but also in efficiency. But chips aren't created out of thin air. Apple had a lot of very talented engineers. And while working for Apple certainly has its perks, some of these engineers wanted to create more complex designs, specifically server-focused CPUs. In early 2019, a couple of former Apple chip architects founded a company called Nuvia. Gerard Williams, Nuvia's new CEO, was previously senior director for platform architecture at Apple, where he worked from 2010 up until he founded Nuvia in 2019. He started working at Apple just before the launch of the A4 and left when the M1 design was already finished. He was one of the major architects behind Apple's entire CPU and SoC development for 9 years. Manu Gulati, also a founder at Nuvia, joined Apple in 2009 and was the lead SoC architect starting with the A5X all the way up to the A12X. He left Apple in 2017 for a short 2-year stay at Google's SoC department before co-founding Nuvia. John Bruno, the third co-founder, also worked at Apple from 2012 to 2017 as a systems architect. He also had a short 1.5-year stay at Google before starting Nuvia. As you can see, all three Nuvia founders were major players in Apple's silicon journey and had extensive experience and knowledge of how to design a world-class ARM architecture. Of course, Nuvia had many more talented employees aside of the three founders, a lot of them with an Apple or ARM background. Apple didn't like that at all. Losing chip design talent to a new startup hurts, and Apple responded with a lawsuit alleging that founder and CEO Gerard Williams was plotting to form Nuvia and poach Apple talent while still working at Cupertino. A pretty serious allegation, but also very difficult to prove, especially since California doesn't allow any kind of non-compete contracts. This lawsuit continued for over 3 years until it was dropped by Apple in early 2023. By that time, Nuvia didn't exist anymore. But more on that in just a bit. Back at Nuvia, the engineers started working on their first product, a server-grade SoC called Orion, and its custom ARM CPU core architecture, codenamed Phoenix. Nuvia's goals for Phoenix were very straightforward: achieve the highest single-thread performance and world-class energy efficiency at the same time. Very ambitious, to say the least. But with such an experienced team behind these claims, the startup money came pouring in. Nuvia raised $53 million in its Series A and $240 million in a Series B round. They had the talent, and now they also had the funding to achieve their goals. In August of 2020, Nuvia's John Bruno published an article about Phoenix and shared early performance indications. Compared to the competition, which at the time included AMD's Zen 2, Intel's Sunny Cove, Apple's A13 Bionic, and Qualcomm's Snapdragon 865, Nuvia claimed that its Phoenix architecture would be twice as fast without increasing power consumption. It's interesting that Nuvia compared a server CPU with mobile and laptop chips, but it didn't make these claims any less impressive. Nuvia was on track to deliver a world-class CPU architecture that might even be ahead of the competition. And then everything changed. In March 2021, just 2 years after it was founded, Qualcomm bought Nuvia for $1.4 billion. The goal of the acquisition? Implementing Nuvia's Phoenix CPU architecture into future Snapdragon SoCs. And with the X Elite, that future is finally here. Now you know why the story of the X Elite begins in Cupertino. I think it's important to know the backstory of the X Elite because it plays a major role in why there is so much hype surrounding it. Qualcomm already designs amazing CPU cores, but with the acquisition of Nuvia and the adoption of Phoenix into Snapdragon, there's a real possibility to not only catch up to Apple's M chips in terms of performance and efficiency, but to potentially outclass it. The talent and experience is certainly there. But before we take a look at the hardware of the Snapdragon X Elite and talk about some of its mysteries, there's another lawsuit to talk about that started right after Qualcomm bought Nuvia. And no, it wasn't Apple this time. It was ARM. Now, you might wonder why ARM would sue Qualcomm and Nuvia. It's a head-scratcher for sure. Just like Apple, Nuvia had an ARM architecture license, which allowed them to design their custom Phoenix CPU cores. And the same is true for Qualcomm, another long-term ARM customer with a full architecture license. ARM's reasoning is that Nuvia was initially designing a CPU architecture for servers, which is a much lower volume product than the mobile SoCs Qualcomm is working on. And thus Nuvia had very different licensing terms. The litigation is still ongoing at the moment. But enough about the origins of the X Elite and lawsuits. Let's take a look at the hardware you've been hearing so much about. The Snapdragon X Elite is a complete system on a chip, like previous Snapdragon variants, and combines CPU, GPU, and MPU with MISC areas like display engines, a 5G modem, and of course I/O. It's manufactured in a 4-nanometer process node, most likely TSMC's N4P. And while we don't have an official die size, semi-accurate reports they have measured about 170 to 180 millimeters squared, which puts it right in line with AMD's Phoenix, not the Nuvia one, Intel's Meteor Lake M, and above Apple's M3, which sits at sub 150 millimeters squared. The new M4 chip that Apple just announced might be pretty close in size. The die size of the X Elite leaves no doubt. We are looking at a true laptop class SoC. The CPU inside the X Elite, codenamed Orion with a Y, contains 12 cores divided into 3 clusters with 4 cores each. The cores are based on Nuvia's Phoenix architecture, though I'm sure some changes to the original vision have been made since the acquisition, because a server-focused architecture has different design targets than a low-power laptop SoC. The X Elite has only one CPU core type and does not combine performance and efficiency cores, like most other ARM-based CPUs. Knowing the story behind the X Elite, it does make sense, because Nuvia's Phoenix was a single performance core design and didn't include smaller E-cores. That's why the X Elite only uses P-cores. Qualcomm didn't share much about the cache system, other than the total size of 42 megabytes, most likely a combination of L2 and L3 cache. But we do know that the L2 cache is shared between each 4-core CPU cluster, since the lower tier Snapdragon X Plus, which comes with 2 cores disabled, has the same 42 megabytes of cache. If the L2 cache would be core exclusive, 2 less cores would result in less cache, which clearly isn't the case here. The CPU cores clock between 3.4 GHz for all core workloads and up to 4.2 GHz for two cores on the top-end SKU. Last year, at the initial reveal, Qualcomm talked about up to 4.3 GHz, which means the boost clock has decreased by 100 MHz since then, indicating the yield wasn't good enough to hit 4.3 GHz on the required number of chips. The integrated Adreno GPU supports full DirectX 12, can reach up to 4.6 teraflops, and according to Qualcomm, is outperforming AMD's Phoenix APU by up to 80%. There's not much to add here, we'll have to wait for independent reviews to confirm these claims. Qualcomm shared a bit more on the integrated Hexagon NPU, delivers up to 45 TOPS of INT8. According to Qualcomm, that's enough to locally run the 13 billion parameter model of Llama 2, which would be very cool indeed. And it would be faster than the NPUs in Meteor Lake, Phoenix, and even Apple's M4, though Lunar Lake and AMD's Zen 5 APUs will likely catch up or even outperform the X Elite in this area. Last but certainly not least, there's the memory system. Both the 12-core X Elite and its little brother, the 10-core X Plus, support low-power DDR5X 8448. And if that sounds like a strange number to you, you are right. Last year, at the initial preview, Qualcomm stated that the X Elite would support low-power DDR5X 8533. So we've got another clock speed downgrade in addition to the drop in CPU boost. And while it certainly won't have a big impact on performance, it's another strange development. My guess is that the memory controller wasn't good enough to handle 8533 megatransfers per second, and the downgrade to the strange number of 8448 megatransfers was made in order to increase yield. Looking at the specs of the X Elite, we can see all the ingredients that make a great SoC, but at the same time we know very little about the actual architecture. It's a 12-core CPU in 3 clusters with 4 cores each and 42 megabytes of cache. L2 and L3 cache seems to be shared. But there is nothing more concrete about the actual CPU architecture. How wide is the CPU? How many stages? Specific IPC numbers? Boost behavior? Qualcomm is keeping quiet. All performance claims are either unvalidated, directly from Qualcomm, or from a very controlled environment. Then there is the reduction in CPU boost and memory clocks, compared to the reveal last year, indicating ongoing tweaks to the yield. This isn't uncommon at all, but running an odd memory configuration like low-power DDR5X 8448 is a bit strange. But the biggest mystery is the software. Unlike Apple, Qualcomm doesn't control both hard and software. The Snapdragon X Elite will run Windows for ARM, and it seems like Microsoft will have an exclusive contract with Qualcomm for the Snapdragon X lineup. Windows for ARM isn't new, and every previous attempt has failed. It's not only the lack of a wide range of supported apps, but performance was also subpar in the past. And that's why I'm still not sure about Qualcomm's performance claims for the X Elite. I have no doubt that the CPU architecture initially developed by Nuvia is a world-class design with the potential to rival or even outclass Apple. But I'm doubtful about Microsoft's ability to optimize Windows for ARM in such a way that the X Elite can actually use all of that performance potential. And we can't forget the competition. When Qualcomm announced the X Elite last year, they compared it to Intel's Meteor Lake, AMD's Phoenix, and Apple's M2. But that won't be its competition. Instead, the X Elite will have to compete with Intel's Lunar Lake, combining Lion Cove and Skymon's CPU cores on TSMC's N3B. AMD is close to launch its Zen 5 Strix Point APUs, and Apple just announced the M4 produced in TSMC's new N3E node. The competition this year will be a lot stronger than it was last year. There are many reasons to be hyped about Qualcomm's next-gen laptop SoC, especially considering the exciting history of the chip development. But at the same time, being so close to the official launch, we still know very little about the actual silicon and its final performance running Windows. I'm hoping the Snapdragon X Elite will live up to the hype and finally make Windows on ARM a viable option. There's nothing better than competition. And I'm looking forward to more in-depth information about its architecture and the actual silicon. Let me know if you'd be interested in a detailed comparison between the X Elite and the M4. If I can get my hands on actual die shots. I would like to know your thoughts on the X Elite. Do you think that the Nuvia team will be able to deliver what they promised? Or will the chip be gimped by Windows? And if it performs well, could you imagine switching to Windows for ARM? Let me know in the comments below. I hope you found this video interesting, and see you in the next one.